Hi there, everyone. Thanks for joining another one of our Elevating Conversations as a part of our leadership series. We always love learning where everyone is joining us from. So in the chat, for those of you who are in there already, how about you go ahead and pop in where you're tuning in from? And also want to know, how are you doing on a scale of 1 to 5? So 1 being, I need to prioritize myself, my family, my joy, whatever that may be, or on a scale of 5 of all things considered, I'm doing great. So go ahead and pop that in the chat. Awesome, I see some great things coming in, Colorado, New York, UK, all the great things. And don't forget to let your fellow community members know how you are doing. So, my name is Crystal Cooper, Senior Program Manager for Partnership Success, and I'll be your MC today. You'll be seeing me now and a little bit later on during the Q&A portion. Today, we're going to be having a timely conversation on diversifying in invention and innovation, and you're going to hear from some amazing panelists. And so, as we wait for more folks to join in and tune into this conversation, we're going to go over a few housekeeping rules. So, 1, we encourage you to engage with your fellow community members in the chat. And so AnitaB.org staff will be in the chat addressing comments and questions, sharing resources, and they'll place their initials after the comments. 2, feel free to ask questions and converse among your community members in the chat. However, if you do have a question for one of the panelists, be sure to use the Q&A function. And we'll try to get to your question during the Q&A portion of this conversation. We'll try to get to as many questions as we possibly can, and if not, then we will share out those questions a little bit later on. And lastly, there are going to be some gems, words of wisdom, and knowledge drop today. So you can use the hashtag AnitaBElevates to share those nuggets. Again, that's hashtag AnitaBElevates. So let's get this conversation started. I have the great pleasure of introducing our president and CEO of AnitaB.org, Brenda Darden-Wilkerson, who will lead this discussion. Brenda, take it away.
Thanks so much, Crystal. It's great to be here with all of you today. Thank you for joining in. And thank you to our sponsor for today, Discover. So welcome to today's Elevating Conversations webinar, Diversifying Invention and Innovation. But before we get started, I want to thank everyone for participating in our candid conversation, Building an Anti-Racist Society, last week. And to let you know that we'll be continuing that conversation tomorrow at 3 p.m. EST. Please tune in if you can, as we have a lot more to discuss. And now on to today's session. At AnitaB.org, we have been working hard, both within our organization and through our member and partner relationships, to have honest and open conversations about building inclusive communities. Today, against the backdrop of worldwide protests, donations, and conversations in solidarity with the Black community, and with the goal of building a more equal society for all, we are here to talk about the need to diversify the pipeline for invention and innovation. In 2016, businesswomen made up just 12% of inventors granted patents, according to the U.S. Patent Office. Women of color, particularly Black and Hispanic women, are less likely to obtain U.S. patent rights than white women and men, despite the fact that they are the leading groups in the growth of new female-owned businesses over the last 2 decades. Now, this may not come as a surprise, but the reason is multi-layered. First, there is less participation from women in the international property system. Gender bias in the U.S. Patent Trademark Office may impact not only the quality of patents issued to women inventors, but also the probability that they are granted at all. 2, institutional factors may also contribute to the low percentage of inventors who are women. The idea of women having a right to claim their intellectual property is still undervalued. And the idea of supporting women inventors and innovators is not nearly as supported as it needs to be. This is a huge problem for women entrepreneurs, especially if the success of their business is directly linked to the receipt of a patent. And without input from people of all backgrounds and mindsets, we know that some issues will inevitably be underestimated or overlooked. And the world ends up with the potential of only meeting the needs of specific groups of people. So today I am joined by four experts in intellectual property protection to discuss ways in which we can diversify the invention and innovation landscape, especially for women technologists, and influence their access and ability to do great work, which is our mission. And as always, I want to encourage all of us to think about what we can do to address the existing gaps within the computer science and technology sphere when it comes to claiming the right to invent. So now allow me to introduce our panelists. First, I have Susan M. Armstrong, who is the Senior Vice President at Qualcomm, Inc. Susan started at Qualcomm working on Globalstar and then early CDMA base station projects. She was a pioneer in bringing internet protocols to the cellular industry, resulting in the first web surfing on a cellular phone in 1997, and Qualcomm's commercialization of packet data in 1998. Since then, she has held various leadership positions, first responsible for the development and commercialization of all software that drives Qualcomm's chipsets, and then as the head of worldwide customer engineering. In addition to her work on Qualcomm's inventions and new technologies, she has worked extensively with base station makers, carriers, phone and device makers in the US, Asia, and Europe to bring those technologies to market. Welcome, Susan. Next, we have Holly Fechner, a partner at Covington and Burling LLP, co-chair of the firm's technology industry group. Holly advises clients on complex public policy matters that combine legal and political opportunities and risks. Named the top lobbyist by The Hill and nationally ranked by Chambers, Fechner has received the 2019 American Lawyer Magazine Dealmaker of the Year Award. She also serves as adjunct professor at Harvard Kennedy School of Government. Prior to Covington, Fechner was policy director for Senator Edward M. Kennedy of Massachusetts. Welcome, Holly. Next, we have Sheila Lehr, Director and Senior Counsel, Intellectual Property and Brand from Discover Financial Services. As Director and Senior Counsel, Sheila handles all intellectual property issues for the company and advises on brand matters. In order to make intellectual property easily understood by business teams and legal colleagues, she designed and conducted training sessions and built and engaged a productive intellectual property task force that created simple, innovative tools. Sheila was one of 10 leaders company-wide selected to participate in Women in Leadership, a Discover executive training program. Prior to joining Discover, Sheila was managing counsel of marketing and intellectual property for McDonald's Corporation, where she led the global team of legal professionals handling all marketing and intellectual property matters. The team managed the global trademark, patent, domain name, and copyright portfolios and advised on one of the world's most popular sweepstakes, Monopoly, at McDonald's. Welcome. And finally, Joseph W. Jasper Jr., Esquire, attorney and consultant, private practice. As a practicing attorney with private and corporate clients, Joe has nearly 25 years experience in complex litigation, environmental management, process analysis, quality improvement, and organizational consulting. He has managed several public and private organizations and is a recognized expert in the use of statistical techniques as applied to environmental regulatory compliance. At Patel Memorial Institute and Cleveland State University, he directed several global technology transfer and commercialization initiatives. He currently works with small firms to perform technology and IP evaluations to identify and quantify the value of intellectual property and to develop commercialization programs with measurable milestones to improve patenting operations, increase royalty revenue, and minimize overall legal and patenting costs. So welcome, all panelists. I am so excited for today. That was power-packed. I can't wait to hear more about this very important topic that we are going to delve into today. So first, what I'd like to do is define what it is we're talking about. So Sheila, can you tell us a little bit about your work and define what really is intellectual property? We can't hear you, Sheila.
She may be on mute.
Sorry, I was on mute. Sorry. So I'm the intellectual property lawyer at Discover. And so what intellectual property covers is trademark, copyright, trade secrets, and patents. But what we're really going to focus on today is patent. And when somebody has a patent, it gives them an exclusive right to practice an invention. And importantly, it's an exclusive right. But it's fundamentally, it's the legal protection for innovation.
That's awesome. Thank you for that. And so, Joe, I want to throw this over to you. Is there anything you would like to add to that definition? And you mentioned something about quantifying the value of intellectual property. Can you tell us more about that? What does that mean?
Well, as you know, whenever you have an inventor, they are usually the type of person that's very, very excited about their creation because they're bringing something of their own and they're putting it out to the world. The reality is it may be something that someone else has already placed into the world, or it may be something totally new. The question you have to ask is, what value does it bring? You know, how much would this be worth as a business entity? You know, would someone be willing to invest in this idea? So the idea of intellectual property, as Sheila stated, is very broad and covers a lot of areas, but looking at the invention at the onset, when it first comes out, and how you manage that through the commercialization cycle.
Awesome, thank you. And Holly, what institutional biases and societal factors do you think have led to women, and especially women of color, being underrepresented in receiving patents?
Well, Brenna, thank you so much for having me. It's really a pleasure to be here with this distinguished panel. And I do want to reiterate how incredibly important patents are. Obviously, they're important to the individual inventor because this is their creation, this is their idea. But they're also critical to our economy. Patents drive about a third of our gross domestic product in this country, patents and other intellectual property. And so this is a fundamental right. I really do believe that ensuring that we've got full participation in the patent system is a civil rights issue. So what prevents women and people of color from participating fully? I think there are many answers to that question, and there are many stages along the way of somebody's life where they either are encouraged to invent and patent or they're discouraged. And I think part of the way we need to solve this problem is to look at all those different stages and take steps, whether they're steps taken by companies, by universities, by our government to try to fix that. So for example, one of the things we know is that exposure as a child to inventors is really a key to even thinking about whether you're going to invent in the future. Getting the right kind of education, particularly in the STEM fields, is critical. Having the right kind of social supports at work, having mentors, having training, just really practical training in how you go about filing for a patent and getting a patent. So I think there's many steps along the way. And we need to ensure that women and people of color have the opportunities that they deserve to invent and innovate.
That's great. I mean, and then all the things that you said that are needed to encourage someone inventing are the things that we talk about in general around supporting folks in the STEM subjects and what we do as an org to support technologists. So that's so encouraging. So thank you for that. Now, I want to turn this over to Susan. Susan, since we have a highly technical audience, specifically in computation and technology, can you speak to the significance of patented inventions in software?
Yes, so my background is also computer science, and I'm a software engineer by career and both by training and career. And so, you know, if you take a look at what Qualcomm does in the area of wireless technology, in some ways it's irrelevant whether it's actually implemented in hardware or software, and that line tends to shift depending on how flexible you want to be, etc. So it's really important that people don't get, you know, tripped up by thinking, well, this idea, you know, is not patentable in some, because it's going to be implemented in software, because you don't actually know that at the time. My early work in the late 90s was on connecting the first connection of your phone to the internet, and it turns out that was implemented in software. But those ideas, again, don't have to be implemented in software or hardware. And I think one of the things that we've experienced internally to Qualcomm is women and people of color, or people who have not been traditionally used to patenting, they think that you have to have that brilliant light bulb idea when you're working in a research group. And as I think everybody knows, innovation is usually not, you know, some brilliant light bulb idea in your garage. It's usually comes out of a collaborative effort. It usually is building on other people's ideas. And I think some of these myths, if you will, that we tell ourselves about, well, software can't be patented, or if you're in a test function, for example, you don't have those, you know, light bulb ideas that occur to researchers, and so your innovative ideas couldn't be patented. And I think those are the kinds of, those are some of the practical barriers that people think about and stop them from patenting when they're not in a traditional sort of research function and used to patenting. And that's what we found internally to the company. And I just wanted to add, patents and innovation are completely intertwined. What we found internally is when people do try to file for a patent internally, and Qualcomm has a lot of support for filing internally, women in particular tend to get discouraged if their patent is, or their filing is rejected by the patent department. That's something that doesn't necessarily apply to all the men who are filing for patents. And so I think that kind of, we have to look hard at sort of the cultural biases that exist, even in a company that's very pro diversity, very pro patent like Qualcomm, to see what some of those barriers are and remove them. And I think one of them is this, you know, you have to have a hardware or research sort of light bulb idea to be able to be worthy of filing for a patent that is accepted.
That's a great point. And I think, you know, what I love about this conversation already, first of all, I'm learning and I love to learn, is that these issues are, they cross every issue that we talk about around diversity, equity, and inclusion. And being conscious of the barriers that may be stopping innovations and inventions in their tracks, or taking that step towards going for your patent, or going outside your organization, as you mentioned, Susan. I'm so grateful that you mentioned that, is something that we have to be aware of and actively involved in. So I want to move this to the legislative side, and Holly, you can start this, but I want, you know, feedback from everybody. Has there been any recent legislation passed to help address the lack of representation in the patent system or in the ecosystems of innovation? And what action is on the horizon that might also be helpful there that we should be aware of?
Well, it is great news that the U.S. Congress has shown real interest in this issue And I think one of the terrific things about it, it's been bipartisan. It's been both Democrats and Republicans recognize that this is an issue of fairness and justice, but it's also an issue of the economic success of the company and making sure that we don't leave all that untapped potential on the table. So in 2018, the Congress passed a bill called the Success Act. And what that bill did is it directed the U.S. Patent and Trademark Office to take a hard look at this question, to look at all the research that's out there, and to share a report on what they learned, and also to make additional recommendations on what needed to be done. And so they released the Success Act report, and I would really encourage anybody who's interested in this issue to take a look at it, because it's an excellent report. And unfortunately, it does show that vast underrepresentation of women and people of color. Brenda, you mentioned the startling statistic that only 12% of inventions have a woman as the patentee. It's really astounding. And so clearly a lot of work needs to be done. One of the major limitations that they reported in this study was something that makes it even hard to study this issue, which is that there is not good information collected about the demographics of who files for a patent and who gets a patent. The U.S. Patent and Trademark Office does not collect that information. So believe it or not, the researchers who have been working in this field, and we really owe a great debt to them, Dr. Lisa Cook at Michigan State, and Dr. Alex Bell, who was at Harvard, and also the Institute of Women's Policy Research has done a lot of the major research in this area. They have to use name matching software. So, you know, they use an algorithm to sort of figure out who's a man, who's a woman. You know, that works okay. It's a lot more challenging when you look at race. How do you discover race and ethnicity without actually having that reported? So one of the recommendations of the Success Act report was that the USPTO every 2 years do a survey so that they can collect some of this information. We are fully supportive of that. Another very important idea is a bill that's been introduced in Congress. Again, this is a bipartisan bill and it's been introduced in both the House and Senate. It's called the IDEA Act, and what it would do is on a voluntary basis, it would ask for that important demographic data when people filed for a patent, because it's really hard to solve a problem if you don't know exactly what's going on. I mean, I think we know enough about what's going on in this area to take further action, but it will be important, I think, to collect that data and be able to make even additional policy recommendations based on that.
Yeah, thank you. That's so important to know. You know, one of my favorite sayings these days is you measure what you treasure. And if it's important, you'll measure it, right? So yeah. Anybody else want to add to this conversation about those things that might be on the horizon that advocates should be aware of?
Susie was an awesome witness in one of the congressional hearings, so I know she has seen it from the inside.
Yeah, and so there's some incredible there's some incredible research out there, and there's some incredible actually tangible programs for both innovators and inventors and patent holders in both big companies and in small institutions. And when I was doing the testimony that Holly mentioned last year, we got some exposure to some of those. And I can actually, we talked about some of the resources, and I can actually see if I can dig up some of those links to some of those programs. But I was really impressed because yes, you have to measure what you treasure, absolutely. And these national level legislative efforts to improve the measurement are absolutely essential to moving this needle. But also, Susie Build It Armstrong, I also want to see, you know, what are those kinds of measurements translating into in terms of practical, tangible, accessible programs that both small innovators and innovators in corporations can access. And I'm very happy to see some of these programs move forward. And certainly at Qualcomm, this is a key initiative, not just for inclusion and diversity. I shouldn't say just, but not only for inclusion and diversity, but it's an economic imperative. You know, our numbers are better than some because we have, we file a lot of patents and we have a lot of innovators, and we have been very focused on our hiring and such, but they're still nowhere where we want them to be, and we want them to be high because we don't want to leave all those good ideas on the table. It's very simple.
I mean, it's not only good for individual companies, but it's also good for our country, right? It's good for the economics of our country. So, Joe, I think you were going to say something, and I do also want to ask you about what can employers do to address the situation and potentially even diversify their patent teams.
Going back to what you said, it is a matter of equity, diversity, and inclusion. So it's very similar to other things in life. We know that in order to get a meal, you have to be at the table. And it's a lot of times it's a table that you don't have access to. So I think the initiative being taken, particularly Sheila mentioned that they have a IP task force in a corporation. And I believe that IP task force is looking out to find those high performers that they can move and push into those areas to get the benefit of their ideas. So one of the things that has to happen is that women and minorities have to be placed on those types of task force, on those teams by the corporations. They have some control there. For the individual inventors, the private folks, you're going to have to go out and become aware of other networks of inventors that are out there. Who are the people that are there as angel investors? Have you ever gone to an angel investor meeting? Typically, there will be a local quasi-public partnership that will assist young companies, maybe helping them get into incubators, maybe helping them work with their IP, making those connections for them to know, hey, I've got some IP, this is who I need to talk to because I was involved with, IP Indianapolis or IP Washington, D.C. So I think those links are very critical, and corporations have to go out, as Sheila said, her corporation was, and they're establishing those. And in the private sector, that also has to be done.
Agreed. Sheila, do you want to add anything to that conversation around employers and what employers can do?
Yeah, I think there's a lot that employers can do in terms of creating diversity within those that protect patents and those who create the inventions. It first starts with obviously hiring, recruiting, and retaining, right? And then obviously it's about creating diversity in the pipeline. It's creating diversity in terms of who's on the interviewing panel. And then ultimately, as you mentioned, Brenda, it's, measuring what you treasure. If diversity is a true goal, at some point you do have to measure outcome and have goals and be held accountable for meeting those goals. And so there has to be clarity, I think, at the highest levels of the organization as to what are the goals and are we going to hold ourselves accountable for meeting them. I think the other thing that corporations can do in terms of creating diversity is providing opportunities for women and minorities to serve in roles that has visibility, like an IP task force, an innovation task force. I think in most organizations today, because of the importance of innovation, I think you'll be hard pressed to find any corporation today that doesn't say that innovation is critically important to the future success of the organization. So those are roles that I think would be are valued within the organization, and those that are on those teams should seek out diversity by design. So that's important. And then, you know, to some of the points that Susie made, I thought it was very interesting when Susie said that she has found in her experience that women inventors maybe are counting themselves out too soon, not understanding that that invention can be incremental and still be protectable, and don't be discouraged. And part of that is training as well. Training folks to let them know what is potentially protectable, and don't rule anything out at the beginning, because if it's something that's of value, we will certainly explore patent protection.
You know, Brenda, go ahead, Holly.
Well, I'd love to just agree with what both Joseph and Sheila have said about the many different steps that employers can take. One thing we've seen recently is a development where some companies have been undertaking a very conscious internal look at how patenting happens in the company and what are the roadblocks for women and people of color in terms of their participation in inventing and patenting. And in fact, the Intellectual Property Patent Owners Association, IPO, has put together a toolkit for companies to use. I know, you know, some people are using the IPO toolkit, some people are coming up with their own way of doing this. But I think what I really like about it is it's built on to all the diversity and inclusion and belonging steps that companies can take. It's just a very conscious look at what happens within this company in terms of how people invent and patent, and how can we improve it?
So what I'm hearing, and that's what I was hearing throughout the whole conversation, is that what we need is intentionality. We don't need the things that you just celebrate when things happen, but we need to intentionally think about how can we encourage it, support it, cut down any roadblocks to it. And I really like to expand this even outside the companies, because as a country, we benefit when we have inventors and they get their patents. So what are ways that, you know, outside of individual companies that we could encourage invention and seeking patents? I heard earlier, I think, Holly, you said we need to impact students at an early age and expose them to inventors. How could we actually improve? We have an opportunity now to share with folks how we can improve this process. And I'll throw that out to anyone.
Well, I will throw it over to Susie, because I know they have a terrific project which does exactly this. But just to focus a minute on the research, Dr. Alex Bell has some amazing findings about children growing up both as children of inventors and people who patent, but it's not just if they grow up as children of inventors. If they grow up in neighborhoods where there are parents who invent, they've done some amazing economic research about what he calls the exposure effects in childhood. And he's got a map of the United States that shows this exposure effect on children. And look, you can't choose your parents, you know, you can't even choose your neighborhood. So we have to recognize that the exposure effect is real and think again intentionally of ways to ensure that all children get the exposure that they need. So there's a lot of great programs, and that's one way to do it.
Yeah. Susie, you want to add to that?
Yeah, you know, I think what Holly's referring to is we have a STEM and an invention engagement program called the Think of It Lab, and it's targeted for middle schoolers, and it's targeted for underrepresented middle schoolers, so students of color and economically disadvantaged students and girls. In sixth to eighth grade is really the target, although I tried it on some staff members in Congress a couple of years ago. It was pretty fun. they come in and, and I have a lot of fun with it too. The students come in and they learn about careers in STEM. It's partially a pipeline. You know, how can a student aspire to a career that they don't know exists? And most of us at that age, and I think students now at you know, middle school, you know about soft, maybe you know about software engineers, maybe you know about hardware engineers, but you don't know anything in between. So we expose them to careers. We also talk to them about the Internet of Things. We're a communications company, network communications company. And then they go and the key part is it demystifies engineering. It demystifies the process of invention. And you get kids, it's not a competition. It's free. You don't want, you know, you can just watch some of these kids come into some of these competitions and just shut down when they're faced with some other kid who's, you know, parents are engineers and have done this for a long time. And we really stress the piece that, you know, on top of these, you know, 5G technologies and such, this is the playing field, if you will, for them to create inventions of their own need. And so they go and they do a simulate, they program an Arduino board and they do a simulated IoT invention. And the most amazing things come out of this program. My favorite is the simulated machine that dresses you and puts your makeup on in bed. But and we all laugh. But it really shows these kids. It sort of demystifies what invention actually is, and it shows these underrepresented kids that these kinds of invention, this, you know, patenting and inventing is not necessarily just for the, you know, the Caucasian, you know, white boy whose parents are engineers. And it's been very, very effective. You know, I hope I live to see that machine come out. to get these kids to think about going on in some of these fields, and to think about what a patent really is and what an invention really is, and it's in their control.
That's awesome. You know, a seed has to be planted so that you know what you can be, and to get ideas outside of whatever the normal one right. for any group. Is really important. So Joe, I want to throw this over to you. I really want to hear more about when you talk about valuation, you know, what part does the inventor play in that? And how can we help women inventors do more to advocate for themselves in that way? Or what is it about them that they can bring to that process that could make it more successful?
I think that you have to look at, and both for the private companies and for the individual inventors or the small startup firms, you know, it's got to be a realization that there has to be some money to support this initiative. You know, there has to be some angel capital, there has to be some seed funding. You know, there are five stages pretty much that go through, even internally at a corporation. You're going to have an idea that idea has to pass muster to show the corporation that it has value. So I think it's critical that the inventor understands that even though it's his invention, it's a great, his or her invention, it's a great thing, it has to show value for it to be taken by the corporation or moved into the marketplace. You know, if you have a startup firm, you're not going to know about potential funding mechanisms if you don't go out and find out where those seed investors are. You know, if you don't try to make contacts with those mid-level funding corporations that are saying, hey, you're here now, we can give you some more money to further develop that technology. Developing technology is not a cheap enterprise nowadays. You know, it is not just, you know, going out in the backyard and throwing two things together and bang, it's there. I think all of the councils for patent can say, you know, those are expensive items that the corporation has to absorb. And the idea has to be valuable enough for the corporation to expend its resources.
So So, and I want to have everybody chime in on this, because we talked about this before we jumped on. The patent process is expensive, I hear. Very. And that there is a right time to jump in and do that. So speak to that, please.
The time when you're, you know, everyone thinks that that patent is going to, and I heard one of the other speakers say it earlier, that there's going to be this eureka moment, and that, you know, you're going to go out and run down the block and get your patent. Well, it typically doesn't happen that way. You're working on a project and something comes along and, hey, this may or may not be patentable. So you've got to look at it in that continuum. When does it have some value? You know, you may find something that's there and say, great, we don't really need to patent it right now. We need to keep working on the idea to bring it along a little bit further. You know, there are provisional patents that they can enter into that are very, very limited, basically gives you a limited protection of time where you can just put the basic idea out there and kind of put a bookmark or hold your space out there in the inventor world. Understanding that system, the whole movement through the patent process, is very important for the inventors that are trying to be there or those on the invention teams.
If I could just add to that, I think that's, the patent does absolutely have to have value to the, you know, to society or the corporation. And so timing is really important. And I also very much believe in, you know, corporations, there has to be support around this. And I'd also stress that you come up with an idea and maybe the timing isn't right. And maybe you're patent, you know, your patent department said, okay, this timing isn't right, let's put it on the shelf for a while. What we have found, we've done some internal studies, and what we have found is girls, especially women, they're not girls, we're not girls anymore, but women, we wish, women are tend to be very self-critical, and if their first filing is you know, rejected or put on the shelf, nice as our patent department is about it, they tend to get discouraged. And I think what we're trying to work on is how can we, how can we indicate to these women that this is just the first step in the process, and is your initial idea, and you learn from it. And the company benefits from those initial ideas as well, because as we talked about before, there's incremental moves and there's incremental patents. And so the very act of getting your idea out on well, we don't do it on paper anymore, but you know, written down, mm-hmm. and going through this process is really valuable. And we have to make sure that people understand, whether it's women or people of color, that your first filing does not have to be your last, even if it's not accepted. That kind of perseverance is something that we have to culturally change, you know, companies and society to make sure that we get that point across. And I think a lot of the research actually shows that, you know, not that we're going to pick on men, but men are much more apt to be able to, you know, fill out the forms and leave things blank and not have a perfect idea and submit it. And women tend to, okay, form's got to be perfect. I've got to fill out every aspect of it. And so that ends up being another barrier to filing and then the eventual granting of a patent.
That's a whole other conversation we could get into across the board, right? So, I want us to, I see that we're running close to time, and I want us to make sure we give our audience an opportunity to ask the great panel any questions they might have. So, Crystal, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Thanks so much, Brenda. This has been an amazing discussion, and I've definitely appreciated hearing about what some of that process might look like and how we can open up the gates for more communities of color and for women. And so there's some great discussion happening in the chat, and there's also a question that came through. You all talked about the iterative process and knowing and understanding that process. And so if you could give like just a quick breakdown, I don't know if it's as simple as five steps, right? But if you could give a quick breakdown and helping folks, what are the things they need to do to understand that process better from start to finish? Like, what are some of the action items folks might take or how they might collaborate internally with their companies to just better understand the patent process?
Why don't we start with you, Sheila? Can you start us off?
Yeah, so some of what we do is training and what is protectable to begin with. So understanding what some of the basic requirements are for a patent protection, certainly that it has to be new, it has to be novel. And we do spend in our business a lot of times talking about current issues like the Ellis case, which is an important case in the software space. But it's really kind of training in terms of we generally encourage if you have anything that you think benefits the business that you think is innovative and new, contact us earlier rather than later. And often when you get the first contact, you know, we're not ready to file a patent application, but we at least can have the conversation with them in terms of at what point in the process where they flush out the execution of their idea, do they touch base with us again? And then we start putting the patent application together. But our basic focus is to say, come earlier and come often, and we're happy to have the conversation and don't rule yourself out.
Anybody else want to add to that?
I would just try to piggyback on that. Understand that throughout the process, there is this whole thing of proof of concept. So you've got to be able to put the work in up front to make sure that the proof of concept is good, that it is solid, that there is documentation that's sufficient for your patenting team to work with and go out and get one.
So important. So it's not just in your head, right?
Exactly.
And what else?
I think the other thing that's important, and not to go back to it again, but just this whole idea of exposure. If you're in a team within a corporation, or if you're working in a research lab, or you're out there as a startup firm, you know, associating yourself with other people in that sphere will help you out, because you will see where they are and what they are doing, you know, what's on the team. And I think every inventor, as we've heard earlier, has hit this case where I thought it was a great invention, but it didn't go anywhere. But that didn't stop them from starting again.
Exactly. If I can add to that, one of my colleagues who is a very shy person, woman, and she has a fantastic story about how she's now got a number of patents in the process technology area, and she wrote her first, filing attempt for our internal patent department, and it was rejected. And they always give you a really good reason, and are very supportive and such. And she was, of course, very discouraged. But they also said, well, why don't you come sit? We have an internal patent review board that's made up of, not only patent attorneys, but people who have patented before and peers. And so she sat in on the patent review board process. And that was sort of an aha moment for her to see, okay, what did get accepted, what didn't get accepted. So there's some, if you're in a corporation, there are some practical things you can observe to help you in the next one. And I guess I would just reiterate that that you have to have perseverance, and that's not saying that it's the responsibility of girls and people of color to make sure they get the numbers up themselves. There's a lot of wonderful programs both outside and inside corporations, but ultimately the inventor or the would-be inventor and the would-be patent grantee needs to be encouraged to have that perseverance, because I think it's pretty rare that your first attempt at getting a patent granted is successful.
Agreed.
Thanks all. So we have another question that came through, really interesting. And so we know that oftentimes the way for underrepresented groups to make headway or to pivot into this area in new sectors is just to make headway in new sectors as they develop. And so, for instance, in California, there's been new opportunities opened up in the cannabis industry as it became legalized. So are there similar opportunities as it relates to environmental innovation or software solutions for women founders, you know, to watch?
I'm messing with my mute key. So I think that's a fantastic question. And I think there are huge opportunities. I just had a chance to judge the university pitch, some university pitch competitions for seed funding. And it was all around, it was the Fowler Social Innovation competitions. And the ideas were astounding, and it was not focused on patents, although some of the students had already, these college students had already had patents pending. And I think in the social innovation space and in the environmental space, because I'm an old environmentalist from the 70s, I think there's a huge opportunity here for people in these areas to move the world forward, not only from the point of view of, you know, diverse innovation and patents, but also move the world forward in areas that it really needs to be moved forward, social innovation, environmental innovation. So I think that's a fantastic idea. And I think some of these programs, melding these programs for pitch competitions with the importance of patenting, I think would be a really interesting area I would love to be involved in.
I did want to mention Jessica Matthews, who is a young Nigerian-American inventor. And I think this is exactly what the question goes to, is she invented a way for a soccer ball that's being kicked around to capture energy, and she patented it. And she started a company that has multiple patents now that's based on this concept. But really, it just came from her community in Nigeria and the issues she saw about the need to capture energy. And who doesn't want to, you know, what kid doesn't want to play soccer all day? And the idea that you're sort of putting that together and inventing something that makes a social good out of the kids playing soccer. And of course, you know, this idea she had has now turned into a company with multiple patents and multiple products. So it's, you know, it's really exciting to see the fact that when you diversify who is inventing, you come up with different inventions. And that's really exciting.
I just want to add to that. When you mentioned Jessica, just she was solving a problem that she uniquely would see, because she's a United States citizen, but also has roots in Nigeria. She's used to having power here. There were power issues there. Voila, right? And so it really talks to diversity. I wouldn't have come up with that. I don't experience lack of power, right? Just her background alone made her valuable as an inventor there. And so it's so important to know that what you have experienced in your life may be the very key thing that makes your invention important. And so don't forget that. So anyway, somebody else was going to say something, but I wanted to get that in there.
Absolutely. And just to follow on that, one of the ways that people, researchers decide whether a patent is particularly valuable is how often it's cited in other patent applications, the citation rate. And one of the really awesome findings is that mixed gender teams have the higher rate of citation, meaning that the teams that produce these patents, the fact that you're having people come together from different perspectives, bring different ideas to the table, makes the ideas, the patents, even more valuable. And I think that research is borne out across many different areas where diverse teams produce stronger results. But it's really exciting that we've got some researchers who have shown that in this area too.
I just like to state, I think one of the better things to use is cooperative research and development grants. Brenda, you were talking in regard to how it would be good for our nation. Well, we have a number of federal labs and we have a number of research universities, and these research universities, they have some brilliant minds working for them. And they come up with research that is very, very valuable. And particularly for some of the larger private sector corporations, you can partner with those young minds. You can partner with those universities and bring that technology out into the marketplace and, you know, possibly license it for your firm or for some other firm. But establishing those partnerships, going into those universities and looking for cooperative agreements, I think is very valuable. And I think the government will also sometimes kick in a few dollars to help you along.
That's a great idea. That's a great idea. Sheila, I'm going to give you the last word before we close up. Anything you want to add to this discussion?
No, yeah, I think it's, thank you so much for hosting. I think bringing diversity to innovation is critically important. I love the example of the soccer ball. That's a classic of a different perspective, a diverse perspective that creates new ideas. And so thank you so much.
Yeah, it's awesome. And thank you guys for all of your hard work, you know, not only being here and sharing with us, because we just got just a little bit, and I'm so grateful for it. I've learned so much. But thank you for all that you do in our community to make invention and patents available to more people. We're going to be dropping more information about our panelists, not only in chat, but also follow up on our website, where we will have a recording of today. Crystal, do you want to wrap us up in any way before we close?
Yes, thank you all so much for joining us. This was a great conversation, and you know, there are so many opportunities as we can see out there, right? From funding to programming to legislation to company backing and support. And so it is all of our responsibility to do this. And so one thing that as we close up, I'd like to leave you with is our all new career fair. And so our Hired Now event happening next month on July 17th, the registration just opened up. I believe that was yesterday. So please, this is a great way for all of you out there to connect with each other, to connect with companies. And maybe this is something you might discover as you are thinking about patenting and all those things. So please make sure that you join us in this critical and fun-filled event, our career fair. And
thank you, Crystal.
Yes, thank you so
much. Go ahead.
And lastly, yes. And, go ahead, Brenda.
No, I'm sorry. I keep breaking into you. We just want to make sure that we thank our sponsor, Discover, today. And we want to make sure that you don't miss tomorrow's webinar, Building an Anti-Racist Society, a Candid Discussion, Part 2. And again, before we go, we want to encourage every member of our audience to draw upon the topics we discussed in today's conversation and commit to taking the necessary steps in supporting yourself as an innovator as we look to the future. So thank you once again for joining us. Hope to see you tomorrow and have a great day.